Hello everyone, I'm Brian Crydragon, but then again, if you come to my streams, you know that. Just give me a moment here. Yes, Alex, hello, you're very cute. What? What? Yes, Alex? You're fine. What? Yes, Alex, you're very pretty. You're a very pretty kitten. Now, let's get started, carrying on from last week, or really gonna restarting from last week.
To ancient Egyptians, the Nile was much more than a water supply. It was a source of precious materials, like mud. Like Egyptians today, ancient Egyptians mixed mud from the Nile's bank with straw and pebbles to strengthen it. Then they poured the mixture into wooden frames. When dry, these bricks were used to build houses. Potters also put Nile mud and clay to good use. Ancient potters didn't have the wheel like they do today, but not much else has changed. People stored practically everything in pots like these, from beer and wine to grain and oil. In fact, pots were considered one of the most important items in an Egyptian home. And they still are. Like their ancestors, modern Egyptians depend on these large clay pots every day.
Well, that's the video. Now let's carry on. Through Egypt! Huh. Hunting, fishing, and fowling. Egyptians didn't need to hunt. They got most of their food from farming, but both for sport and to bring home a little extra to eat. Egyptians hunted all kinds of animals and birds. Armed with arrows, spears, and throw sticks, they paddled through the marshes and hiked along the nearby desert in search of exotic game like hippos, antelopes, ostriches, and crocodiles. Hunting hounds. Pharaohs and noblemen hunted ostriches, antelopes, lions, and other prey in style. They raced across the desert in chariots or on foot, trying to catch their prey with lassos or bolas. Sometimes they shot arrows and threw spears. Like hunters today, they used dogs to track and round up prey. Their favorite hunting companion was a type of greyhound, a graceful, swift dog that could keep up with the fastest animal. But no one ever caught the speedy and elusive Achech, a half bird, half lion creature that Egyptians believe roamed the desert. The sport of kings. This golden ornament was found in the tomb of Tutankhamun. It shows the king, accompanied by his trusty hounds, hunting ostriches from his chariot. Hippos and crocodiles. Hippos in zoos may seem like gentle giants, but these huge beasts can be ferocious and do great damage. Thousands of hippos lived along the Nile, a constant threat to people who lived and worked near the river. Hippos blundered through farmers' fields, tore fishermen's nets, and crushed reed boats. What's in a name? The Greek traveler and historian Herodotus was the first outsider to describe how Egyptians hunted hippos. He gave the animal the name we still use today, hippopotamus, which means river horse in Greek. Harpooning the hippo. Hunters went after hippos in skiffs made of papyrus reeds. First, they snared a hippopotamus with ropes, then they speared it again and again until it died. Fishing. Just like fishermen today, Egyptians loved to take a boat out onto the water. Some used poles and hooks and spent a lazy day waiting for a perch, catfish, or eel to bite. Others worked in teams, dragging nets through the water to bring in a good catch. Young, strong fishermen with keen eyes and quick reflexes stayed near the shore and used long harpoons to spear their favorite fish. traps and tricks. If you had a good eye and strong arm, you could bring down a duck or goose with a throw stick, a kind of boomerang. Hunting this way was a favorite sport of noblemen. Often the whole family went along. One tomb painting even shows the family cat helping to catch some ducks. Clever hunters used decoys or camouflage to get close to a flock, then hurled a throw stick to stun or cripple a bird. Caught in a web. To catch lots of birds, hunters laid out a net covered with bait. When a flock landed, the hunters quickly pulled the nest closed, trapping the flock. A weapon for show. King Akhenaten may have carried the sprightly colored throw stick in ceremonies. Made of faience, a kind of glass, it was too fragile to use for hunting, but it shows the graceful shape of these hunting tools. A journey to the afterlife. To an Egyptian, no event in life was more important than death. Without a proper funeral, the spirit and body could not reunite in the afterworld. The careful construction of a tomb, elaborate preservation of the body, and valuable offerings to the gods were just the beginning of the spirit's long journey. The funeral. Oh, for goodness sake. Yeah, well, that's... That's better. No, it's not. The funeral. The trip to the tomb started at the dead person's home. The body, sealed in a mummy case and carried by bearers, led the procession. Next came a ceremonial sled carrying a chest that held the internal organs in canopic jars. Last came the grief-stricken family and friends. Wealthy families paid dancers to celebrate the eternal life to come and hired professional mourners, who wailed loudly, tore at their hair, and beat their chests in grief. Professional mourners. Well, that's very interesting. Oh, jeez. Opening the mouth. Outside the tomb, the funeral procession stopped so the priests could perform a special ceremony called opening the mouth. That's better. The mummy was propped up in the sand. As the priest said special prayers, he touched the mummy's mouth with ceremonial tunes. This ritual restored the body's senses and enabled it to eat and drink in the afterlife. Magic tunes. A priest used these utensils to perform the ceremony of opening the mouth. He poured sacred liquids from the small cups and touched the mummy's mouth with the forked instrument. That's quite interesting, isn't it? In the book Egyptology, I recall there's a page that there's a section of that cover that features a picture of that, but we don't really see that in the fiction now, do we? Now, I've seen quite a few films with Egypt as the setting, but I don't recall ever ancient Egypt as the setting, but I don't recall ever seeing the opening of the mouth. Funeral barge. The Egyptians believed the soul had to cross a river to complete its journey, but the ferrymen, Makaf, would not carry the soul across until it had named each part of the boat. The Greeks had a similar legend. They left a coin with the body to pay the ferryman, Charon, to take the soul across the river Styx. A king's last journey. The elaborate funeral barges carried the pharaohs to their tombs. The boats were often painted green to signify the renewal of life. As the barge traveled slowly down the river, the pharaoh's subjects mourned his passing. Outpouring of grief. A modern archaeologist experienced the ancient funeral spectacle firsthand when he moved dozens of mummies from a tomb. As the boat carrying the pharaoh's bodies sailed down the Nile, thousands of Egyptians lined the river banks, railing in grief. Weighing the heart. Anubis weighed the heart against the feather of the goddess Mat, who symbolized truth and justice. If heart and feather balanced, the person had lived a good life, but if the heart was heavy with bad deeds, a crocodile-headed monster called Ammit, the gobbler, snatched it from the scales without a heart. The person cannot enter the kingdom of the dead. The Book of the Dead. Tombs and mummy cases were often covered with prayers from the Book of the Dead. These magic spells and prayers helped the spirits complete the dangerous journey to the afterlife. Gods of the Dead. Embalmers wore a jackal mask as they prepared a mummy for the tomb. They wanted to please Anubis, the jackal-headed god who protected cemeteries and helped judge the dead. At the ceremony called the Weighing of the Heart. King of the Dead. Osiris was only shown as a pharaoh holding the royal scepter and flail. Legend said that Osiris was magically restored to life after his brother Seth murdered him. For the Egyptians, Osiris represented never-ending life. Yes, I remember learning about that in high school. Well, not as much learning as reading a graphic novel about it. It was an educational one. Very educational. Actually, besides graphic novels for educational purposes, there were a few for entertainment value, but the educational ones were quite good. Oh, excuse me. Tomb treasures. Egyptians tried to make sure that the gods would accept a person's spirit after death. The family of a dead person gave amulets to the embalmers who wrapped them among the mummy's bandages. But grave robbers destroyed many mummies. They ripped the bandages apart to steal the valuable amulets. Beetle-shaped amulets were made into rings and other treasures. They represented the sun god Khepri, who died each night and then awoke at dawn. Beetle amulets were often placed over a mummy's heart, and inscribed with a prayer that the person's spirit would be revived along with Khepri. Backbone of a god. This amulet, called the Jed Pillar, represented the backbone of Osiris. Egyptians believed it restored strength and power to the mummy. Fascinating. Well, that's we've still got a way to go before we reach Greece. Yes, quite the way to go indeed. But still, we've got to keep on trekking through the sands of Egypt. Good lord, do I ever sound corny. Well, carrying on. What am I doing? Life on the Nile. More than just a source of water, the Nile brought life itself to Egypt. Each year, the river flooded, bringing fertile new soil to the farmers' fields. People also used the thick mud to make bricks for houses. South of the marshy delta, all of daily life took place in a narrow strip of land that is hundreds of kilometers long, but never more than 21 kilometers wide. In fact, only soldiers and traders ever traveled more than a few kilometers from the Nile's banks. That makes a decent amount of sense. Each year, farmers started working the fields in October, when the Nile's annual flood receded. Like Egyptian farmers today, they planted grain, barley, and vegetables with only simple wooden plows to break up the soil. Before the flood returned in the late spring, everyone in the family worked long, hard hours to harvest the crops by hand, watering the soil. To convert more desert into farmland, Egyptians built canals and dikes. Egyptian farmers today still use a simple crane called a shadif to fill the canals with buckets of water from the river. Boat building. To paddle through the marshes in the delta or for short trips up and down the Nile, a simple papyrus boat worked just fine. Made from bundles of papyrus reeds, these light, simple watercraft were inexpensive and easy to handle. Traveling far up the Nile or along the coast required larger boats, however. For trading expeditions, skilled craftsmen built fast sailboats that could carry big loads and outrun pirates. Funeral barge. Beautifully decorated boats carried the bodies of the pharaoh and other wealthy Egyptians to tombs on the west side of the Nile. That trip symbolized their voyage to the afterlife. This model of a funeral barge was found in the tomb of Tutankhamun. Would have been great to see the treasures when they were last in Toronto. That was years ago. Farm animals. An Egyptian farm was full of animals, from cattle and goats to sheep and pigs. Cows were especially useful. They pulled plows, gave milk, and helped harvest and thresh grain. In fact, most people measured their wealth by the number of cattle they owned. Sacrificial bull. Special animals were reserved for religious ceremonies. During festivals, bones were washed, decorated with flowers, and led to a temple to be sacrificed to the gods. Playing on the Nile. The Nile was the best playground in all of Egypt. When tug-of-war, catch, and other games got boring, the river was always close by for swimming, fishing, and boat racing. But playing in the river wasn't all fun and games. Someone had to keep a lookout for crocodiles and hippos. Man overboard. In one popular game, teams stood on boats and tried to knock one another into the water with long reed poles. Fish or fowl? Even people who couldn't afford to raise cattle or sheep for food could catch plenty of fish in the Nile. One type of fish called the tilapia was especially tasty. You can even buy that kind of fish today in supermarkets all over the world. The marshes along the river also attracted lots of ducks and geese. The makings of a tasty meal. A good catch. The best way to snare birds was with a big net. People spread the net out on the grass and sprinkled some seed over it. After the birds landed, the hunters quickly pulled a rope to close the trap. Sacred bird. One water bird, the ibis, was sacred. With its long curved beak, it was the symbol of Thoth, god of wisdom and healing. The Nile today. Visiting the villages that lie along the banks of the Nile is like stepping into the distant past. On any morning, you can see people doing their laundry, bathing, or swimming in the river, just as their ancestors did thousands of years ago. People even still use ancient tools to irrigate their fields, and a boat is still the best way to travel through Egypt. Click the play button to take a look at modern life along the Nile. Yeah, I'll do that. Let it play, and then I'll go. I'm not gonna go far. Jeez, how big is this thing?
Along a narrow strip of land on either side of the Nile, ancient Egyptians developed a way of living that can still be seen today. It was, and is, a life tied to the river. Egyptians used boats to travel the river like people today use cars to travel highways. Along its banks, people gathered to wash, swim, and play. But perhaps the Nile's greatest gift to Egypt was its annual flood. Each year, the river left fresh, rich soil behind for the farmers. For Egyptian farmers, the flood marked the beginning of the year. When the waters went down, they went to work. Everyone worked, including the animals. Strong, healthy animals were so important to the survival of a farm that people measured their wealth by the number of cattle they owned. To irrigate the land, the Egyptians developed a system of dikes and canals. This shadouf was designed to make the tedious job of filling the canals a little easier. Bucket by bucket, people lifted water from the river and channeled it into the canals, as they still do today.
Okay, well, that's life on the Nile. Now we move on. Yes, now we move on. Give me a second. To magic and medicine. Now, I believe this is where I got to last time before things got, well, let's just say it didn't go over well. Something wrong with Twitch and my stream stopped at the 25-minute mark. Magic and medicine. Detailed medical texts. Hundreds of recipes for medicines. And prayers to cure illnesses prove that the Egyptians worried about their health. Doctors were carefully trained, and they specialized in treating different parts of the body. The Egyptians believed that most illness was caused by worm-like creatures, evil gods, or a person's bad deeds. From the elegant lotus blossom to the humble garlic bulb, many plants were revered in ancient Egypt. Excuse me. The sweet aroma of the lotus flower was the very breath of life. While other plants provided potent medicines. In fact, some people in Egypt still follow ancient recipes to make medicines from these plants today. Henna. Finely ground leaves from the henna plant could color the hair and skin. Egyptians also believed the powder could ward off danger. Potent garlic. Egyptians thought garlic kept snakes away and expelled tapeworms. That's not such a strange belief. Even in more recent times, legends said that garlic repulsed vampires. Today, many people take garlic pills for better health. Power to purify. Priests used the juice from juniper berries during purification rituals after a person died. Horus, the god of the home. To keep their families safe, many people kept a stone plaque of Horus in their homes. Called a stela, this plaque shows Horus guarding the family by gripping snakes and scorpions. To receive his magical protection, family drank water that had been poured over La Stella. Crocodile Keeper. On the Magic Stella, Horus stood on the heads of crocodiles. Egyptians believed he kept the man-eating reptiles from snatching people from the river banks. That's not it. I want Rendo, not video capture. There we go. A real sacrifice. To keep the gods happy, Egyptians offered many kinds of animals to the gods, from bones and goats to ducks and geese. Religious sacrifices remained important through the centuries. In Rome, cults sacrificed bones to the god Mithras, shown in this statue. Ceremonial calf. Animals offered to the gods had to be purified, just like people who entered the temples. Before they were given to the priests, the animals were carefully washed and decorated with flowers. Excuse me. Yes, I'm still on magic and medicine. Amulets and magic charms. As beautiful as jewels, amulets were much more than decoration. Egyptians believed amulets pleased the gods and brought divine protection from illness, dangerous animals, and evil spirits. People wore amulets as necklaces, bracelets, rings, and pins. Even animals and mummies wore amulets. When a person died, the family made sure that amulets were wrapped in with the mummy's bandages to please the gods of the dead. Sacred symbols. Amulets came in all shapes and sizes. Some looked like strange animals that represented the many forms a god could take. Other amulets were mystical symbols of a god's power. Surgery and suffering. Egyptian surgeons knew how to take care of many types of injuries. They treated bad teeth, fixed broken bones, and bandaged wounds. Some experts think they may have even tried brain surgery. Doctors followed strict written procedures because if they made a mistake and the patient died, the family could sue in court. Doctors found guilty of malpractice could be put to death. A surgeon's tools. Surgeons all over the ancient world used tools much like these from Greece. They aren't much different from modern instruments. In fact, a surgeon today would know just how to use these scalps, tweezers, and metal probes. Anesthetics. These jars once held opium, a powerful painkiller. Doctors may have used opium to put a patient to sleep during surgery. The gods of healing. Even the most skilled doctors often couldn't help someone with a bad infection or serious injury. When a doctor's skill and potent medicine failed, the patient's only hope lay in the supernatural powers of the gods who could expel evil spirits. Family Guardian. In time of need, many Egyptians turned first to the strange dwarf god Bes, who danced on a sacred lotus flower that symbolized life. He often carried a tambourine in one hand and a sword to repel danger in the other. Prayer Tablet. Sometimes people chiseled appeals to the gods on stone tablets. To make sure the gods would hear their prayers, the writers inscribed ears next to the words. Well, with all those ears, I don't imagine there's a way for them to not hear. Modern Egypt. Dams have tamed the great river's floods, cars jam city streets, and cruise ships sail the Nile. But even among all the signs of the modern world, you can still find symbols of the Egyptian civilization that endured for more than 3,000 years. Felucas. Just like the boats shown in ancient tomb paintings, stone sail the Nile. Today's farmers plow and irrigate fields with the same tools their ancestors used long before the pyramids were built. And Gamal Abdel Nasser, the man who restored Egypt's independence in the early 1950s, is as revered as any pharaoh. Islamic Egypt. When the religion of Islam brought a new god to Egypt 1300 years ago, mosques replaced the pharaoh's temples as houses of worship. But the link to the old ways wasn't broken entirely. Through the centuries, Muslim rulers built mosques with stones taken from the monuments erected by the pharaohs. Holy Book. The Quran is the sacred scripture of Islam, and the earliest known work in Arabic literature. Today, almost 1400 years after it was first written down, scribes don't carefully copy the Quran's graceful Arabic script as art to honor God. A mixture of old and new. The rooftops in the old part of Cairo seem to extend forever. Many of the buildings are made with mud bricks, just like those used to build villages 5,000 years ago. Temples and palaces, ancient, medieval, and modern, dot the landscape, reminders of Egypt's long history. Time-tested transport. Modern streets cross the Egyptian cities today, but horse-drawn carts are a common sight in traffic jams caused by thousands of cars. Cairo. Today, more than 14 million people live in Cairo. Some parts of Egypt's capital city are packed with high-rise office towers and world-class hotels. Other areas are crowded with the homes of people who live according to traditions thousands of years old. History close at hand. The Great Pyramids are only minutes from the modern city of Cairo. You can ride a city bus right to the foot of ancient monuments. Much of the art and many treasures from ancient Egypt, including those from Tutankhamun's tomb, are now on display in the Egyptian Museum. Farming the Nile. Dams have controlled the river's annual flood since the 1960s. But mastering the river has not put an end to Egypt's traditional ways. Like their fathers before them, today's farmers tend their animals and crops in a strip of land along the river. Ancient pump. Today's farmers still lift water from the Nile into their irrigation canals with a shadif. Shadouf. An ancient Egyptian farmer would know exactly how to use this tool. Its design has remained unchanged for thousands of years. Tourist trade. Since the late 18th century, when Napoleon rediscovered the land of the pharaohs, tourism has been big business in Egypt. Wealthy travelers came to buy pieces of history, from small statues to entire monuments. Today, the ancient sites are protected and the great treasure are secure in museums for all to see. I'll be right back in just a moment. I'm fine. Mummies for sale. Until about 100 years ago, anyone could buy a mummy from a salesman on the street. What the hell? Business wasn't always good, however. This salesman is taking a nap next to his mummies, which have been sleeping for thousands of years. Yeah, that's messed up. That is really messed up. People and politics. From the Persian conquest in 525 BC up to modern times, Egypt was a colony of many foreign powers. In the 1950s, Gamal Abdel Nasser finally forced the British to withdraw their troops. Soon after, Nasser, the son of a mailman, became president of the country. He was the first person to rule an independent Egypt since the time of the pharaohs. Since the time of the last pharaoh of the native populace, perhaps. Long after he died in 1970, Nasir remains a hero to millions of Arabs. Latest leader. President since 1981. Yeah, this is a bit dated. Hosni Mubarak was also a soldier and government official. Maintaining the peace between Egypt and her neighbors remains his greatest challenge. Peacemaker. Anwar al-Sadat took over the presidency after Nasir's death in 1979. Okay, let's see here. Gamal Abdel Nasser. Yeah, 1970, so that's a typo. He signed a peace treaty, with Israel, ending years of fighting between Egyptians and Israelis. Islamic fundamentalists who opposed his peace efforts assassinated Sadat in 1981. Legacy of Egypt. There's no mystery about who built the newest Great Pyramid or why. This huge hotel and casino in Las Vegas is a temple for gamblers and tourists. And the Sphinx that stands in front beckons visitors with a brilliant laser light show. The New Luxor. The new pyramid in Las Vegas is no silent tomb. The glass hotel has more than 2,500 rooms, and in the huge casino deep inside, gamblers play mysterious games of chance night and day. Billions of pyramids. A pyramid with a divine eye appears on the back of every U.S. dollar bill, part of the Great Seal of the United States. The pyramid is inscribed with the date 1776 in Roman numerals and is surrounded by Latin mottos that mean "He has smiled on our undertakings" and "New Order of the Ages." River people. Today, skyscrapers and factories loom over the banks of Egypt's ancient highway, the Nile. But follow the river just a few miles out of town and you'll find a different world. Here, people still follow the old ways, farming and fishing just as their ancestors did in the time of the pharaohs. Click the play button to see what life is like today along the Nile. Didn't we just watch this? Hold on. Yeah, we just watched this. Nile life, so... Wait, what's papyrus? Sure, we'll get to it eventually. And let's watch. Let's watch Nile life again.
Along a narrow strip of land on either side of the Nile, ancient Egyptians developed a way of living that
Stop.
Can still be... Along a narrow strip of land on either side of the Nile, ancient Egyptians developed a way of living that can still be seen today. It was, and is, a life tied to the river. Egyptians used boats to travel the river like people today use cars to travel highways. Along its banks, people gathered to wash, swim, and play. But perhaps the Nile's greatest gift to Egypt was its annual flood. Each year, the river left fresh, rich soil behind for the farmers. For Egyptian farmers, the flood marked the beginning of the year. When the waters went down, they went to work. Everyone worked, including the animals. Strong, healthy animals were so important to the survival of a farm that people measured their wealth by the number of cattle they owned. To irrigate the land, the Egyptians developed a system of dikes and canals. This shadouf was designed to make the tedious job of filling the canals a little easier. Bucket by bucket, people lifted water from the river and channeled it into the canals, as they still do today.
Yeah, that actually was in the same one. Right, so, carrying on, Mummies, eternal bodies. Actually, not a bad name for a documentary. Mummies, Eternal Bodies. Yeah, that would make a great name for a documentary. What's a mummy? It's really just a preserved body. Scientists and explorers have found mummies frozen in glaciers and sealed deep in marshes. But the most famous mummies came from ancient Egypt, where thousands of years ago, embalmers carefully preserved bodies. They did their work well. Today, many Egyptian mummies are more than 3,000 years old. When we cut away their bandages, faces stare back. The faces of people who created a great civilization thousands of years ago. Preparing for the tomb. Making a mummy in ancient Egypt was something like modern surgery. Following detailed procedures, the embalmers removed the internal organs and sealed them in canopic jars. To preserve the skin, they rubbed the body with palm oil, and then dried it in natron, a special salt. Only then did they wrap the corpse and seal it in a mummy case, ready for the tomb. It's a wrap! Embalmers stuffed the empty body with cloth and wrapped it with linen bandages, placing magic charms called amulets between the layers. Finally, they covered the face with a mummy mask and sealed the body in a coffin. An embalmer's tools. Preserving the face was important, so embalmers didn't cut open the head to remove the brain. Instead, they inserted hooks and spoons through the nose and scooped out the brain. Quiet, you. Modern mummies. The ancient Egyptians weren't the only people who mummified their dead. Scholars and explorers have found mummies all over the world. Even today, many cultures preserve the bodies of important people to remind everyone of historic events. Curled up corpse. People in Peru once mummified their dead too. Unlike the Egyptians, they curled the body into a sitting position and placed its hands against its feet. Shrine for a leader. Millions of visitors traveled to Moscow to see the body of Vladimir Lenin, leader of the Communist Revolution. Embalmers developed a secret technique to preserve his body. Some experts, however, think the body in a glass coffin is just a wax dummy. I remember sometime in, what was it, the late 90s? Probably in the late 90s. There was a lot of documentaries about mummies. It was the only thing anyone was watching. My house, my grandparents' house. There was no escaping it. There was absolutely no escaping it. Creeped me out. Scared me. I don't know why. No, I think I might know why. It's because it's... because they were creepy looking. Magic for sale. There's money to be made from mummies. For hundreds of years, tourists bought mummies and mummy parts in Egypt. What the hell? Europeans found mummies so fascinating that they displayed them in their parlors. Some Egyptians, however, had a more practical use for mummies. Because mummies were soaked in oils and resins, they burned easily. So, in a land where wood is scarce, many people used the ancient bodies as fuel for cooking. Okay, then. Magic and mystery. 300 years ago, finely ground mummy parts were used in medicines and special paints. Pricey parts. Until recently, visitors to Egypt bought mummy parts, especially heads, as souvenirs. Today, most mummies are in museums, but Hollywood still copies them for horror movies and makes models of real mummy heads for films like Raiders of the Lost Ark. Unlike Nosferatu the Vampire, it's just rents somewhere that had actual mummies and just filmed them. Just filmed the real things. Mummy cases. Inlaid jewels, layers of gold, and brightly painted symbols covered the coffins of the ancient Egyptians. Usually made of wood, mummy cases were supposed to help preserve the body and protect it from thieves and animals. The cases were more than colorful containers, however. The painted faces helped the spirit recognize its body. And the magic symbols helped guide the spirit through the afterlife. Canopic jars. Parts of the body could be used in a magic spell against a person, living or dead. So the Egyptians preserved all the internal organs in special containers called canopic jars. The intestines, stomach, liver, and lungs were dried, wrapped in linen, and sealed in separate jars. What the hell is... Okay. Animal mummies. To the Egyptians, many animals represented both the power of the gods to create life and the never-ending cycles of nature. Animals weren't just pets or sources of food. Lions, hippos, crocodiles, snakes, and many other animals reminded people of the awesome powers of nature and commanded great respect. Daughter of the Sun. The cat goddess Bastet was the daughter of the sun god Ra. She represented the power of the sun to ripen crops, and was especially important to the Egyptians. The temple to Bastet contained many bronze cat figures. Are you my mummy? Mummies may seem full of mystery, but for scientists, these ancient bodies actually answer a lot of questions. By taking x-rays and conducting medical tests, experts can learn how old people were when they died, what they ate, what made people sick, and how they died. Experts have learned a lot from the body of the great Pharaoh Ramses II. For example, his mummy proves that Ramses II was wounded in battle. But obviously he didn't die in battle, I mean, lived to be 90. A look inside. This x-ray of Ramses II's mummy shows that he was missing a tooth. His back teeth are badly worn. To make sure his distinctive profile remained intact, embalmers stuffed his nose with peppercorns. Well, again, he was 90 years old, so... I don't know what you're expecting of a 90-year-old before the invention of dentures! Eyewitness account. For centuries, visitors wondered how the ancient Egyptians had made mummies. Did they know of some special process for preserving the body? No one was certain, because the bombers and priests did not write down all the steps of the ancient rituals. It wasn't until a Greek traveler named Herodotus visited Egypt that an outsider recorded the mysterious process. Tales of Travel. When he returned from his travels, Herodotus amazed Greek audiences with his tales of exotic people and places. Taking Notes. Herodotus traveled around the ancient world and wrote about the strange and different cultures he encountered. He actually watched ancient embalmers at work. To hear him describe the work, how they made a mummy click the button, you won't really be able to hear that, so let's not do that. Let's just carry on through our journey through Egypt. I mean, we might reach Greece today. Great Pharaohs of the New Kingdom. An emperor, a religious fanatic, a young boy, a woman, and a warrior. These were among the great pharaohs of the New Kingdom. In just 500 years, the blink of an eye in Egypt's long history, the kings of this period overturned the old order, built and tore down cities, and finally restored Egypt's glory as an empire and a great military power. Hatshepsut. As a pharaoh, Hatshepsut didn't think her temple should be any less impressive than those built for the men who had ruled Egypt. Hatshepsut never commanded an army, but during her long and peaceful reign, she organized a great expedition to the land of Punt and built many temples. But her successor and stepson, Thutmose III, may have thought she was too powerful. When she died, he ordered her name erased from every monument in Egypt. Royal tribute. Like many kings before her, Hatshepsut added the great temple of Amun-Ra at Karnak. Hatshepsut added to the great temple of Amun-Ra at Karnak. The obelisk, almost 30 meters tall, was carved from a single piece of rose granite. At one time, it was covered in gold, making it a shaft of light and tribute to Amun-Ra. Excuse me. Akhenaten, the heretic king. Many pharaohs waged war and built empires, but Akhenaten created a new religion. He took the throne as Amenhotep IV, but he soon changed his name to honor his god, Aten, the sun disk. Totally devoted to Aten, Akhenaten built a new capital city called Amarna, and filled it with palaces and hundreds of shrines open to the light of the sun. Lifelike art. Akhenaten didn't just overturn Egypt's religious conventions, he also revolutionized art. Akhenaten's palaces were filled with paintings and sculpture that presented nature realistically and portrayed a relaxed and informal royal family. But after Akhenaten's death, artists returned to the old, more rigid style. Sun worshippers. Akhenaten Inn believed the sun brought life to him, his queen Nefertiti, and their daughters. In this belief, each ray of the sun ends in an Ankh sign, the symbol of life to the ancient Egyptians. Tutankhamun, the best known pharaoh of ancient Egypt, took the throne as a boy and died. He may have been murdered. Dated history. Before he turned 20. During his short reign, he restored temples at Karnak and other holy sites destroyed by his uncle Akhenaten. We now know him to be both son and nephew to Akhenaten. But he accomplished little else. Many experts now think Tutankhamun was just a puppet manipulated by the powerful priests at Thebes. If the treasures from his tomb had not survived, Tutankhamun would be all but forgotten today. Priceless memories. Millions of people have seen treasures from Tutankhamun's tomb. Unfortunately, I'm not one of them. This famous scene on Tutankhamun's golden throne shows his sister wife tenderly rubbing him with soothing ointment. Yes, sir. Ankhsenamun was both half-sister, technically. Half-sister and cousin to, Tutankhamun. The Great Ramses. If kings were judged by their monuments, Ramses II would be the greatest pharaoh in Egypt's history. He ruled for more than 60 years and built more temples and colossal statues than any other Egyptian king. He even put his name on temples built by other kings. But while the monuments tell of his great military victories, Ramses II may not have been a good general. In his most important battle, his army barely escaped from the Hittites, and he spent much of his reign desperately fighting off invaders. That's actually fictional. That's a mistake. The Egyptians decimated the Hittite army at the Battle of Kadesh, but they never managed to capture the fortress of Kadesh itself. King of Karnak. Many pharaohs built monuments at Karnak, but Ramses II finished the great hypostyle hall, the centerpiece of Egypt's greatest temple. Some of the huge columns are nearly 21 meters high and 3.6 meters in diameter. Well, this is different. Thutmose III, the Conqueror. Modern historians call Thutmose III the Napoleon of Egypt. That must make Powhatan the Napoleon of the indigenous Americas. He probably stood only a little over 1.5 meters. But he led great armies that seized cities, captured thousands of enemy soldiers, and brought back great treasure to Egypt. a daring leader. Thutmose III was a man who plunged into battle when his generals advised him to be more cautious. But after waiting more than 20 years to take Egypt's throne, he must have been like a tightly coiled spring, ready to leap into action. And we'll just skip the hearing his story part. Queens of the Nile. Nefertiti, Hatshepsut, and Cleopatra. They are the most famous queens of Egypt, but none was quite what she seemed. Nefertiti, a regal beauty, probably wasn't of royal birth, but she had extraordinary power as the favorite queen of the pharaoh Akhenaten. Hatshepsut, first a queen of a powerful pharaoh, came to rule Egypt as its king, dressed in full royal costume. Egypt was the last and most famous queen of the Nile, but she wasn't even an Egyptian. By nationality, she was of Greek stock. Macedonian, specifically. The heretic king and queen. For more than a decade, Nefertiti and her husband Akhenaten worshipped the sun god Aten and the new city of Amarna. The entire city, all of its palaces and shrines, was dedicated to Aten, but when Akhenaten died, Nefertiti disappeared. Did she die before her husband? Did she change her name and take over the throne? Or was she banished, perhaps murdered when Tutankhamun ordered the destruction of Amarna? No one is certain. Yes, what indeed. Elegant Queen. Archaeologists found this bust of Nefertiti in a sculptor's workshop in the abandoned city of Amarna. It is one of the most famous pieces of art from ancient Egypt. Akhenaten. Nefertiti was married to this strange-looking king. Experts aren't sure if statues and reliefs accurately show how he looked, or if he ordered artists to portray him in an exotic new style. Well, if his bones are any indication, it was an exaggeration of his appearance. A tragic end. No queen of Egypt met a more dramatic end than Cleopatra. At least that's how the story goes. Mark Antony, her husband and a Roman general, lost a great battle for control of the Roman Empire. When Cleopatra learned that the victor would add Egypt to his empire and parade her through Rome as a prisoner, she committed suicide. A quick death. According to the legend, Cleopatra held an asp to her chest and let it bite her. Scientists say the snake's venom would have caused her heart to stop. Although this picture shows a small, dainty snake, she might really have been bitten by a cobra. A modern legacy. Cleopatra. Even her name includes the Greek word for fame. Thanks to the movies and stars like Elizabeth Taylor, Cleopatra has become one of the most glamorous figures of the ancient world. For millions of people around the world, this image of Cleopatra remains the very picture of an Egyptian queen. In fact, movies have often made Egyptian clones, hairstyles, and makeup the latest fashion craze. The real Cleopatra. This ancient relief shows what Cleopatra may have really looked like. According to these images, she was somewhat less of a beauty than her Hollywood counterparts. A queen's tomb. The person buried in this magnificent tomb was Hatshepsut, the woman who ruled Egypt for more than 20 years as pharaoh. During her long reign, Egypt prospered. Hatshepsut sent a great expedition to the land of Punt, and she built many temples. But her tomb was damaged, and much of its artwork destroyed not long after she died. This vandalism wasn't the work of tomb robbers, many experts think. It was done on the order of her successor and nephew, Thutmose III. That's not an error. Hatshepsut actually was married to her brother. Unless Thutmose III, being her brother's son, is her nephew. Golden Monument. This obelisk at Karnak celebrated Hatshepsut's reign. She ordered its construction as part of the restoration of the temples. Once covered in gold, it was a gleaming tribute to Amun-Ra, the sun god. A stepson's revenge. Thutmose III, the prince who became the greatest military leader in all of Egypt's history, probably wasn't a patient man. Some experts say that when he finally became pharaoh, an angry Thutmose III ordered Hatshepsut's name chiseled off every monument in Egypt, even from the tops of the great obelisks she built at Karnak. The Egyptian Napoleon. Thutmose III was a small man, barely over 15 meters tall. But his great military campaigns make modern historians compare him to another short general, Napoleon. He was only short by today's standards. The great and peaceful pharaoh. Who was this regal-looking woman who ruled Egypt as a pharaoh? Was she an evil aunt who stole her stepson's throne? Or a great queen who stepped in to save Egypt and avoid a crisis? Click the button to hear her story. You won't really be able to hear it, but... yeah, let's just skip this. Oh look, Cleopatra again. Movie Queen. The life and death of Cleopatra have been the subject of countless plays, paintings, and movies. Ancient writers said Cleopatra was intelligent and powerful, but they didn't describe her as beautiful. But when Hollywood made a movie about the great queen, it chose its most glamorous star to play the role. Click the play button to see Elizabeth Taylor as Cleopatra, Queen of the Nile. Just a moment. We can watch it again. Get ready for a crazy pixelated clip from Cleopatra. But apparently not that pixelated. 20th Century Fox or whoever it was who made it can still recognize it.
3 days now I've waited for an audience with you alone. What is the purpose of the audience?
Now get out, all of you. I wish to see Your Majesty privately.
You stand before the throne of Egypt.
I know where I am!
You will state your purpose.
Matters I have no intention of discussing publicly.
I do not grant private audiences to unidentified persons.
I am Marcus Antonius.
I know who you are. What are you at the moment?
Envoy of Rome, proconsul of all the Roman Empire to the east of Italy.
An impressive title.
Worthy, perhaps, of a private audience.
Without a treaty of alliance with Egypt, you could not hold the territories under your command. True?
Possibly.
Then, Lord Antony, you come before me as a suppliant.
If you choose to regard me as such.
I do. You will therefore assume the position of a suppliant before this throne. You will kneel.
I will what?
On your knees.
You dare ask the proconsul of the Roman Empire?
I asked it of Julius Caesar. I demand it of you.
Yes, well, I'm carrying on. Rulers of the Old Kingdom. The pyramids are like huge pointers on the timeline of Egypt's history. The greatest accomplishments of the era, known as the Old Kingdom. This period was the first time that Upper and Lower Egypt were united into one great civilization. The pyramids show that even 5,000 years ago, Egyptian society was well-organized and had many highly skilled workers. More than 20 kings ruled during the four centuries of the Old Kingdom, but none capture our imagination like the kings who built these magnificent tombs. I do not think we'll be getting to Greece today. I mean, who knows? Maybe we will. Khufu. Good king? Bad king? King Khufu, often known as Cheops, ordered his workers to assemble the Great Pyramid, the largest structure ever built. But today, this huge stone monument and a single statue are all that's left of his accomplishments. People used to think that Khufu was a tyrant who forced thousands of slaves to build a monument to his ego. Today, most experts agree that Khufu organized and provided work for about 4,000 craftsmen and thousands of everyday laborers. But the truth about Khufu, like empty chambers in his pyramid, will probably always be a mystery. King Djoser, a step ahead. Perhaps it's fitting that we know little about the king who built the first pyramid, for it was really his chief aide, Imhotep, who had the revolutionary idea of making a tomb in the shape of a pyramid. In fact, in later years, Imhotep came to be worshipped as a god. Djoser, the king he served, has slipped into... Djoser, the king he served, has slipped into obscurity. Today, A chipped stone statue is the only reminder of this early king. First Pyramid. The tomb of King Djoser became Egypt's first pyramid. Called the Step Pyramid, it was the first monument in Egypt to be built of cut stone instead of bricks made from sun-dried mud. A country united. According to legend, a king named Menes was the first ruler to unite Upper and Lower Egypt. Some experts think Menes was King Narmer, and that the Narmer Palette celebrates his victory over the king of Lower Egypt. That battle united the two regions. Whoever he was, the first king founded a capital city at Memphis, at the point where Upper and Lower Egypt meet. From this time on, Egyptian kings were known as Lords of the Two Lands. Victorious King. One side of the Narmer Palette shows a king wearing the white crown of the South, about to kill a rival leader, who wears the red crown of the North. This side of the stone may have been used to grind pigments for a nobleman's makeup. Timetable of the Pharaohs. Here are the kings who ruled Egypt during the Old Kingdom. It was an extraordinary time in Egypt's history. The study of mathematics, medicine, astronomy, and art flourished, creating the foundation of a civilization that lasted another 3,000 years. Yeah, so that's it. That's the timetable. And looks like we'll be watching this video again. Great Monuments of Ancient Egypt. It's difficult to imagine how people working without bulldozers and cranes could have built such colossal structures as the pyramids. But the Egyptians were remarkable engineers using only basic mathematics. They built not only pyramids, but magnificent temples as well. Click the play button to see the grandest monuments of ancient Egypt, then and now.
The great monument.
Stop, no. There we go.
The great monuments of ancient Egypt are still amazing, even today. But imagine how they must have looked in ancient times. They weren't dull stone buildings, but shining tributes to the gods and kings. The Step Pyramid at Saqqara may not seem so impressive now, but it was the first building made entirely of cut stone block anywhere in the world. And it was a dramatic new shape for a royal tomb. The first tombs for pharaohs looked like this, but Imhotep, an ancient architect, added several layers to the basic design. The pyramid he built is like a giant stairway to the sky. The Step Pyramid didn't stand alone. It was part of a huge complex that included a courtyard for public gatherings and several small decorated rooms. A stone wall about 2 stories high surrounded the pyramid and other buildings. The wall had one grand gate and many false doors. The most famous pyramids are at Giza. They look a little worn down after 5,000 years of desert storms and damage from thieves and scavengers. But once these monuments glittered like jewels in the desert. They were covered with smooth, polished limestone, and some experts think they were capped with gold. Even the Sphinx may have been brightly painted. Inside each pyramid are secret passages that lead to a burial chamber. Once these tombs were filled with gold, furniture, even food, to make the king comfortable in the afterlife. Today they are empty because thieves long ago removed everything of value. The temple at Karnak is the largest place of worship ever built, but it wasn't created all at once. Over the centuries, many pharaohs added to the temple, each trying to please the greatest god of ancient Egypt, Amun-Ra. Now, the tourists walking among the ruins can only imagine Karnak as it once was, built not just of dull stone blocks, but bright and full of life. The immense columns of the hypostyle hall were vividly painted, and splendid obelisks were once polished rose-colored granite and covered in gold. Mysterious shrines were rich with color, the smell of incense, the sound of rattling sistrums, and the chanting of priests and priestesses. The Step Pyramid, the Great Pyramids at Giza, and the Temple of Karnak are still awe-inspiring today. But just imagine the wonder they created in the ancient Egyptians, thousands of years ago.
My right foot's falling asleep. Sailing on the Nile. The Nile was ancient Egypt's highway, as busy as a freeway. It traveled by thousands of small papyrus boats, graceful wooden sailing craft, and the beautifully decorated funeral barges of the pharaohs. Even today, with cars, trains, and airplanes for transport, the Nile is still Egypt's main thoroughfare. The Ra Expedition. Thor Heyerdahl, a Norwegian anthropologist, believes that Egyptians may have taken their culture to the Aztec and Incan civilizations 4,000 years ago. To show that the Egyptians could have made the trip, he built a papyrus boat. Then, using only the skins and tools known to ancient sailors, he set out across the ocean. Ra the Second. Heyerdahl crossed the Atlantic in this boat made of papyrus reeds. His first attempt failed, but in 1970, the second boat named Ra II held together for the 57-day voyage. Why hasn't that got in a movie? That would be fascinating. A movie? Why hasn't it gotten a miniseries? Gone Fishing. Everyone in ancient Egypt lived close to the river, and almost everyone had a boat or knew how to make one from papyrus. Like modern people who still live near the Nile, ancient Egyptians used hooks and nets to catch catfish, eels, and other fish. A quick job. In shallow water, the best way to catch a favorite type of fish was with a spear or harpoon, if you were patient and had quick reflexes. A trip to Punt. Egyptians didn't like to leave their own country, but at the command of Hatshepsut, the great woman who ruled Egypt as pharaoh, an expedition set out for the land of Punt. No one knows for certain where that mysterious kingdom lay, but it was probably near present-day Somalia. Hatshepsut's ships returned with cinnamon, monkeys, ivory, and gold. Sailing ships. Papyrus boats were fine for traveling on the Nile, but on the trip to Punt, the Egyptians sailed in wooden boats. Thick ropes wrapped around the hull helped hold the planks together in the stormy waters. The Nile today. Egyptians don't sail the Nile in boats that look exactly like the craft shown in paintings from ancient tombs. One, called a felucca, is a swift boat with a triangular sail. These boats sail downstream with the current and are towed back upstream from the banks of the river. 2,000 years ago, the Greek historian Herodotus said the Nile was crowded with such boats just as it is today. Floating hotel. Today, visitors to Egypt can travel up and down the Nile in comfort. Cruise ships stop at all the important temples and monuments. I'm just gonna check my schedule. Excuse me, let's keep going for a bit. Scribes and scholars. In a country where only a few people could read and write, scribes were important and respected. Like lawyers and government officials, they wrote letters and kept records, but they also watched over the pharaoh's estates, collected taxes, and supervised the construction of tombs. Scribes were so essential, in fact, that they didn't pay taxes, serve in the army, or endure backbreaking work in the fields or stone quarries. Famous scribe. Some scribes took their talents to new heights. Imhotep was the trusted aide of King Djoser, one of the first kings of Egypt. Imhotep was more than a scribe. He was also a physician and, it turned out, a great architect. When Djoser asked him to build a tomb, Imhotep designed the first pyramid. Step Pyramid. This six-story tomb stands 61 meters tall. It is the first structure ever built out of cut stone blocks. Imhotep, the man who created it, is also the first artist whose name is known to history. making paper. Have you ever wondered where the word paper comes from? The Greeks named the Egyptian writing material papyrus, after the tall green plant that grows in the Nile marshes. To make paper, strips of papyrus were placed in layers, then pounded flat with a mallet or stone. The plant's sap welded the strips together into a smooth sheet. Still in use. The papyrus plant no longer grows wild in the Nile Delta, but you can still buy papyrus in stationery stores. Painting a tomb. Scribes didn't just add up taxes on papyrus sheets, they also helped create some of Egypt's most important art. When the pharaohs began building pyramids in the Valley of the Kings, workers found that they couldn't cut inscriptions into the hard stone, so the tomb builders painted the burial chambers until the supervision of the scribes. Royal stories. Kings and queens often showed themselves with the gods. This painting from the tomb of Queen Nefertiti shows her with Hathor, the goddess of love and beauty. Counting geese. Scribes kept track of taxes owed the king. This picture shows a scribe counting the number of geese that a nobleman owns so that he can collect the tax owed. Decoding hieroglyphs. Don't worry if you don't understand the message in a wall of hieroglyphs. Neither could most Egyptians. Only a few well-educated people learned to read the signs and symbols. Today, scholars know that hieroglyphs were put together like modern letters to make words and sentences. The ABCs of hieroglyphs. Here's a chart of hieroglyphic characters and their equivalents in English. With this key, you can write stories using this ancient alphabet. Going to check my schedule again. We keep going. Song and dance. You might think that the Egyptians spent all their time making mummies and building tombs, but if you went to an Egyptian party, you'd get a different idea. They loved to celebrate at public festivals and private banquets, and no party was complete without music and a troupe of dancers. Celebration dance. Egyptians celebrated everything from a good harvest to a visit from an old friend. Like any good party, these special occasions called for lots of food, drink, music, and dancing. But men and women didn't care. men and women didn't dance with one another. Instead, they enjoyed the feast and watched dancing girls move to the music. rhythm section. Flutes and harps may have carried the melody of Egyptian music, but these instruments gave it a beat. Cymbals, drums, and sistrums kept the music moving. Even the dancers added to the rhythm by clicking bone clappers like castanets and shaking bracelets and necklaces. Sacred rattle. One instrument, called a sistrum, was used mostly at religious ceremonies. Noblemen and priestesses shook this rattle to honor Hathor, the goddess of joy, music, and dance. Ancient strings. Egyptians enjoyed life to the fullest, and wall paintings like this show how much music meant to them. Women often learned to play stringed instruments like harps and lyres. Some instruments looked like guitars. Others were as tall as a person and had 20 strings. Musical heritage. The Egyptians probably learned about harps in Mesopotamia. Later, when the Greeks traveled the Mediterranean, they copied many of the instruments they saw, including some from Egypt. Temples and priests. Ancient Egypt was a land of temples. But these buildings weren't like churches, synagogues, or mosques where people worship today. Only priests and pharaohs could enter these mansions for the gods. The greatest temple in Egypt was built at Karnak to honor Amun-Ra, the sun god. Each day, the priests purified themselves with water from the sacred lake and made offerings to the god in the secret shrines. Did I say secret or sacred the first time? I can't remember. Today, much of the temple at Karnak has crumbled, but its huge gates, towering columns, and colossal statues are vivid reminders of Egypt's glorious past. A mansion for a god. Built over the centuries by many pharaohs, the temple at Karnak is the largest religious monument in the world. Some pharaohs built new temples, others added colossal statues, obelisks, and shrines. By the time they were finished, the temples and huge gateways at Karnak covered more than 2 hectares. Hypostyle Hall. A forest of huge columns supported the roof in the main hall at Karnak. Each column is about 21 meters tall and nearly 4 meters in diameter. Begun by Ramses I and Seti I, the hall was finally completed by Ramses II, who carved his name over those of the other pharaohs, his father and grandfather. Wow. An emperor in awe. The monuments at Karnak overwhelmed even the mighty Napoleon. In this painting, Napoleon and his staff prepare to enter the brightly painted temple, which is almost filled with sand. Today, the paint is faded, but the sand has been cleared away to show the temple's glory. Sacred rituals. Priests were servants of the gods, not preachers who instructed the people. Each day they tended to the gods' needs. They washed the golden statue in the shrine, dressed it in clean clothes, and offered it food and drink. But no one other than the priests ever witnessed these mysterious ceremonies. Only priests could enter the temple, and even they had to purify themselves by shaving their heads, bathing in water from a sacred lake, and burning incense. Holy water. A bronze container called a citula, and other metal vases, held holy water for washing and purify. Oh, hey, Sunshine, 1994, all is good, all is good. And purifying offerings. Images of the gods and the pharaohs decorated the containers. Priests burned incense in special holders. The sweet-smelling smoke attracted the gods and purified the air in the temple. This bronze incense burner has the head of a hawk at one end. Sunshine Ash, 1994. Sorry about the butchering of the name earlier. Priestly duties. The big temples were cities unto themselves. Priests controlled the nearby farmlands, workshops for skilled craftsmen, and shrines where people left offerings. One of the largest estates included dozens of orchards, thousands of cattle, more than 100 villages, a fleet of boats, and about 80,000 workers. For generations, sons inherited their father's priestly duties and their wealth. Only the pharaoh could break the link by appointing new priests. A thinker. This priest looks worried. In fact, his expression is meant to show that he leads a serious, thoughtful life. He is bald because to purify themselves, priests shaved off all of their hair. Akhenaten, the Pharaoh of the Sun. Some experts believe Akhenaten was a great religious leader, the first person to worship only one god. Others think he just wanted to make himself all-powerful. Whatever his reasons, in the end, Akhenaten failed. When he died, the pharaohs who followed him restored the old gods and temples, and had Akhenaten's name chiseled off of every monument. A place for all. Akhenaten built a grand new capital city called Amarna, and dedicated a magnificent temple to his god Aten. This new temple was not a secret place just for pharaohs and priests. It was filled with altars, open to the sun's light, and everyone was welcome to worship there. Sun worshippers. Akhenaten believed the sun brought life to him. His queen Nefertiti and their daughters in this scene, each ray of the sun. Ends in an Ankh sign, the symbol of life to the ancient Egyptians. a man as a god. Like powerful kings everywhere, Egyptian pharaohs commanded armies, ran the government, and lived in great splendor. But to the Egyptians, a pharaoh was more than a feared and respected ruler. He was a god in human form, the embodiment of the hawk god Horus, and the high priest in the land, and the highest priest in the land, face to face. In this painting, Thutmose III stands before Horus, the hawk-headed god. The Egyptians also thought of Horus as a hawk high in the sky, whose eyes were the sun and the moon. Ankh, the sign of life. Only kings and queens and gods could hold the Ankh sign. To the Egyptians, it symbolized life. A person carrying the Ankh had the power to give life or to take it away. Right, carrying on. Oh boy. Timetable of Ancient Egypt. The world has seen many great civilizations come and go, but none endured as long as the ancient Egyptian culture. Its achievements still hold people everywhere in awe today. And that's just the same, but at a different part of the timetable. Archaic. Before it became one great country, Egypt had been a collection of independent and rival cities. Kings from cities in the northern river delta and the narrow river valley in the south had fought battles for hundreds of years. Then, during the Archaic period, Egypt became a nation. About 5,000 years ago, a king named Menes marched from the south and defeated the northern king. He founded a new capital at Memphis, the center of ancient Egypt, and became the first lord of the two lands. The first king. The famous Narmer palette may show how King Menes of the south defeated his rival, the king of northern Egypt. Time table of ancient Egypt. Oh, jeez, this is the same. But even farther. Oh, really, France only held control of Egypt for 3 years. That's interesting. Actually, maybe it's not. It is France we're talking about. But then again, they were able to keep a war with England going for over 100 years, so maybe they just didn't fare so well in Egypt. Old Kingdom. Never before or since have humans built such huge structures. 500 years after Egypt was united, the pharaohs began building pyramid-shaped tombs. The largest of these monuments became wonders of the ancient world. Although the pyramids were long ago robbed of their treasures, they are still the greatest accomplishments of Egyptian civilization. The first pyramid builder. King Djoser was the first Egyptian king to be buried in a pyramid. His step pyramid was also the first structure ever built out of cut stone blocks. What's this? Oh. Pharaoh match. There were many pharaohs throughout the history of ancient Egypt. Here are some of the most famous. Oh, and this was a game. See if you can match the pharaoh to his or her position on the timeline. Okay, so this was a game. The Middle Kingdom. The royal palace was often in turmoil during the Middle Kingdom. Noblemen throughout the land challenged the pharaoh's absolute power, and one of the first kings of the era was murdered. Still, throughout the Middle Kingdom, Egyptian culture flourished. For example, some of the greatest literature from ancient Egypt was written during this period. But then outsiders called the Hyksos threatened to take control of Egypt. The New Kingdom. The New Kingdom was the time of Egypt's greatest glory. But it was also disrupted by religious upheaval and court intrigue. Great kings, one of them a woman, sent expeditions to far-off countries, conquered foreign lands, and built magnificent temples and tombs in the Valley of the Kings. Tutankhamun, the most famous pharaoh from ancient Egypt, ruled during this period. Ptolemaic rule. Egyptians welcomed Alexander the Great as a savior from the hated Persian occupiers. The dynasty, created by one of his generals, Ptolemy, ruled Egypt for about 300 years. In the great city of Alexandria, the Greeks built monuments like the Pharos, a magnificent lighthouse that became one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. Cleopatra, the last queen. A Greek named Cleopatra was the last woman to rule Egypt. Shown here as the goddess Hathor, Cleopatra held her throne for 20 years. She committed suicide in 30 BC when the Roman Empire took control of Egypt. Roman rule. The Roman Empire claimed many great prizes, but perhaps none was as important as Egypt. Grain from the rich farmland of the Nile Valley fed Rome for hundreds of years, and Egypt was a strategic colony on the trade routes to the east. Roman mummies. Fascinated by the Egyptian way of life, many Romans adopted the customs of the pharaohs. They built monuments, decorated with hieroglyphs, and had their bodies made into mummies after they died. the rise of the Muslim world. Ultimately, the gods of the pharaohs also disappeared from Egypt. Brought across the desert by Arab conquerors in 640, the new religion of Islam overwhelmed the old ways. Worshippers who had said their prayers in the pharaoh's temples and in Christian churches built by the Romans now gathered in mosques. Although a community of Coptic Christians still worships in Egypt, Islam remains the official religion of Egypt today. Daily prayers. 5 times a day, devout worshippers of Islam stop, face Mecca, kneel, and pray. French rule. Like many leaders before him, Napoleon set out to add Egypt to his empire. His fleet landed at Alexandria in 1798, and Napoleon briefly took control of the country. He was soon driven out of Egypt, but not before a team of French scholars studied its ancient monuments, like the pyramids and the great temples at Karnak. Rosetta Stone. A piece of black stone dug up by Napoleon's soldiers became more important than any of the ancient buildings unearthed by the experts. The Rosetta Stone, inscribed in 3 languages, was the key that helped scholars translate the Egyptian hieroglyphs. English rule. The withdrawal of Napoleon's army did not restore Egypt's independence. The British became the next in a long line of foreign powers to rule the country for the next 152 years. Arab kings held the throne in Cairo, but only with the consent of the British government. Modern Egypt. These 3 men are the first Egyptians to have ruled Egypt as an independent country since the Persian conquest in 525 BC. Egyptian kings had taken the country's throne, but only with the consent of foreign powers. Finally, in 1952, a group of Egyptian army officers took over the government, restoring Egypt's freedom for the first time in almost 2,500 years. Current leader. Hosni Mubarak was a soldier and government official before becoming Egypt's president in 1981. He has tried to maintain the peace between Egypt and Israel. First modern leader. In the early 1950s, Gamal Abdel Nasser helped overthrow the British rulers of Egypt and became the newly independent country's first prime minister. Man of Peace. Anwar al-Sadat became president in 1970 when Nasser died, but Islamic fundamentalists, angry that he made peace with Israel in 1979, killed him 2 years later. I wonder if Hosni was one of the killers. Dangers in the tomb. Would you dare to enter a pharaoh's tomb? For as long as grave robbers and archaeologists have explored the ancient crypts, there have been legends about fatal curses and mummies that awaken to stalk anyone who disturbed their slumber. Such stories didn't stop Howard Carter from spending almost 10 years working in Tutankhamun's tomb. But as many grave robbers, adventurers, and scientists discovered, real dangers did await those who broke into a tomb. The Curse of Tutankhamun. A curse on anyone who disturbed King Tutankhamun. It seemed possible when Lord Carnarvon died suddenly only 4 months after he and Howard Carter opened the pharaoh's tomb. Newspapers even said that all the lights in Cairo went out at the moment of Carnarvon's death. But no one has ever found the curse that supposedly was inscribed in the tomb. Carter, who worked in the tomb for almost 10 years, died naturally when he was in his late 60s. Deadly cobra? According to legend, a cobra swallowed Lord Carnarvon's pet canary when Tutankhamun's tomb was opened. Legends said the snake was guarded by the royal cobra on Tutankhamun's mummy mask. Mummy's Revenge. Was it so strange to imagine a mummy rising from its tomb? The famous actor Boris Karloff didn't think so. In 1932, just as archaeologists were finishing their work in Tutankhamun's tomb, Karloff made a mummy called The Mummy. Karloff made a movie called The Mummy. Yes, that does sound like what I just said. He played the mummy of Imhotep, revived when an archaeologist chanted a magic spell. Rich is rich. Karloff studied pictures of the real mummy of Ramses III to make sure his mummy makeup looked real. Can you tell which of these pictures is a movie mummy and which is Ramses III? Well, technically it was Jack Pierce who studied the makeup. Boris Karloff didn't do his own makeup. The one on the right is Boris Karloff, and the one on the left is Ramses III. A Tourist Lost. You might not believe all the stories about the mummy's curse, but one tourist was nearly scared to death in a pharaoh's final resting place. She got lost while visiting the tomb of Ramses II and was trapped inside all night. The next morning, guards found her lying at the foot of the pharaoh's statue, so frightened that she couldn't even talk. A Dangerous Discovery. The first people to break the seals of royal tombs weren't always the first visitors to the burial chambers. More than one archaeologist or tomb robber lit a torch, peered into the darkness, and found himself face to face with a bat or a snake, scorpion, or a rat. Bat Cave. Dark burial chambers are perfect homes for bats. They work their way in through nooks and crannies. Hanging upside down in clusters, they sleep all day. Then at dusk, they leave to feed on insects and fruit. Secrets of the Sphinx. Archaeologists say the Sphinx is a statue of King Khafre. They think the statue shows the king as a regal lion making offerings to the sun god. But this awesome monument may still have a story or two to tell. After lying buried in the sand for thousands of years, the Sphinx was completely uncovered only early in this century. Now, some scientists think tunnels and chambers deep beneath the lion's body may wait to be explored. Just for a reminder for those who catch this on YouTube or those just coming in, this program was actually made in the 1990s. Secret revealed. Legend says that a son of King Amenhotep II dreamed that the statue spoke to him. Following the Sphinx's instruction, the prince cleared the sand from the lion's body. As a reward, he, not one of his older brothers, became Pharaoh Thutmose IV. Not sure if I'll be... Well, I probably will be continuing for quite a while, but... Let's just see. Well, carrying on. Toys and games. Like children everywhere, Egyptian boys and girls love to play. Some of their games, like leapfrog and tug of war, are still favorites of children today. Egyptian children also liked board games, and all kinds of toys. Children must have treasured their toys, just as adults were buried with jewelry and other valuables. Children who died were buried with dolls, wooden toys, and other playthings. Doll or companion. These paddle dolls found in the tombs of pharaohs and the nobility probably weren't toys at all. Instead, they were left as companions or servants for the dead. The craftsmen used a special trick to make sure the dolls would never leave the tomb. Can you figure out what they did? Well, these dolls don't have feet, so they can't run away. Simple toys. Even poor children had toys like these tops made of glazed quartz. They spun the top with a twist of their fingers or a quick pull on a string wrapped around the toy. Snake. A game called Snake is one of the oldest games in Egypt. It was named for its stone board made in the shape of a coiled serpent. The markers were often inscribed with the names of famous pharaohs. I, Ren. To win a game of Snake, you had to be the first to move your marker from the outside ring to the middle of the board. Sonnets, anyone? The goal of Sonnet was to move a marker around a board, capture enemy pieces called kelbs, and reach the kingdom of Osiris. Players tossed throw sticks like dice to determine how far to move the markers. They try to land on the symbols for power, beauty, and other desirable things. But they had to watch out for the squares guarded by hippos and other dangers. Not just a game. For ancient Egyptians, Sennet was more than a game. It was a religious ritual. In this tomb painting, Queen Nefertiti plays Sennet against an invisible opponent. She is trying to pass from this world to the next. Even the name Sennet means passing. There we go. Wooden animals. Egyptian kids played with all kinds of wooden animals, much like the toys you can buy in stores today. Can you imagine which were their favorites? Perhaps the biggest and most ferocious animals? Well, archaeologists have found many toy lions, hippos, and crocodiles in children's tombs. Ferocious feline. The jaw of this animal moves up and down. Do you think it is a fierce lion or a friendly cat? Rare treasures. Wooden toys were precious treasures because wood was so rare in ancient Egypt. Other toys were fashioned from more common materials like clay and mud. Get along. This brightly painted toy horse rolled along behind a child who pulled a string tied to the horse's muzzle. Water sports. After a race, or perhaps when they couldn't find any more fish to catch, boys divided into teams and fought mock sea battles. They stood up in their boats and used poles to knock their opponents into the water. Toy boat. For a child in ancient Egypt, a toy boat must have been the most treasured toy of all. Carefully detailed models like this one were also placed in tombs to help people cross the river of the underworld and reach the kingdom of Osiris. Simple ships. Even kids could make their own boats out of bundles and papyrus. These papyrus reeds were also used to make paper, clothing, and many other necessities in ancient Egypt. How far are we? Oh, we're almost at Greece. Yeah, excuse me. Tutankhamun, the boy king. He was just a boy when he became king. He ruled only 10 years, and he died while still a young man. 18. I beat you there, tot. I'm just joking. You were a good man. As far as we know, he never led an army into battle. So why is Tutankhamun the best known pharaoh from ancient Egypt? It was the efforts of one determined archaeologist, Howard Carter, and the treasures he uncovered that made Tutankhamun's image known around the world. Well, that was then, and now we believe he might have actually led an army into battle. Might have actually been how he ended up with the broken leg that became gangrenous. Yes, he was a good man. Sure, he had a club foot. But even then, he didn't let his disability define him. He led soldiers and perhaps it was his wound in battle that got his leg broken in battle, and that's why it turned gangrenous. A return to the old ways. Tutankhamun would probably want to be remembered for restoring the religion overturned by his uncle Akhenaten. Uncle and father. Tutankhamun rebuilt the temple of Amun-Ra at Karnak. He ordered his subjects to abandon Akhenaten's holy city of Amarna. And he returned the empire's capital to Thebes. Return of the Gods. Tutankhamun, or powerful priests using the boy king's name, ordered artists to create new statues to honor Amun-Ra and the other old gods. At the same time, royal officials destroyed Akhenaten's temples and tried to erase the memory of the heretic king. Mysterious death. Tutankhamun's attempts to restore the old gods may not have been enough to satisfy the powerful priests. Tutankhamun's mummy shows that the king died of a head wound. Not anymore. Although some experts think the injury was caused by an accident, others believe the priests had Tutankhamun murdered. Tomb of Treasures. Gold. It was everywhere in Tutankhamun's tomb. There were small objects, like a decorated fan, that showed the king hunting with his hounds. Golden statues guarded the doors. Large wooden chests and shrines were covered with gold leaf. Into the Afterlife. Detailed paintings in the burial chamber show Tutankhamun's last journey. The new king, prepares Tutankhamun's mummy for the afterlife. The mother of the god, Osiris, and Nut, the mother of the god Osiris, greets Tutankhamun's spirit. A poor pharaoh? The great treasures in Tutankhamun's tomb look spectacular to us, but some scholars say that compared with other pharaohs, Tutankhamun was poor. His burial was arranged quickly, and the treasures were hastily stuffed into the small chambers. Well, Tutankhamun's actual heir, his general Horemheb, was on campaign in Asia when Tutankhamun died, so the burial was probably quickly made so I could seize power. Tomb Discoverer. Who made one of the greatest archaeological discoveries of all time. You might think it was a fearless adventurer, like the explorers shown in movies. Howard Carter was instead a scholarly archaeologist who started working in Egypt when he was just 19. 20 years of patient work finally led him to a tomb hidden in the Valley of the Kings, the tomb of Tutankhamun. Moment of triumph. After years of digging, Carter finally found Tutankhamun's tomb. But that was just the beginning. He spent another 10 years patiently cataloging the tomb's contents and studying his discoveries. A child groom. Every pharaoh needed a wife, even a king who was hardly more than a child. Tutankhamun took the throne when he was only 8 or 9 years old. But he was quickly married, probably to his own sister. His own half-sister and cousin, to be precise. That seems strange today, but in ancient Egypt, members of the royal family sometimes married one another to keep control of the throne. Yeah, it was to make sure there was no cadet branches. Yeah, how would that work out for you? A tender moment. The back of Tutankhamun's golden throne is decorated with lacine, and shows the young queen rubbing Tutankhamun with perfumed ointment. Howard Carter. When Howard Carter discovered the forgotten tomb of King Tutankhamun, he opened a door into greater understanding of ancient Egypt. Archaeologists had always known that pharaohs were buried with great ceremony and that their mummies were surrounded by unimaginable wealth. But the tombs of most great kings had been robbed thousands of years ago. Tutankhamun's tomb, however, remained almost untouched. It gave us an idea of the splendor of ancient Egypt. Click the play button to see Howard Carter uncovering the mysteries of Tutankhamun's tomb. Just one moment.
The great son of a...
No! No! We're not doing that one again. That's not what we're on. Stop. Do not start just yet.
In 1922, Howard Carter made a discovery that caught the attention of the world. After years of searching, he uncovered the tomb of King Tutankhamun, a tomb virtually untouched for more than 3,000 years. Overnight, the dry and desolate Valley of the Kings seemed to come to life. People traveled from all over the world to see what Carter and his team of experts would find in the burial chambers, and they weren't disappointed. The team emerged with an awesome array of weapons, clothing, jewelry, musical instruments, model boats, and furniture. It took them 10 years to bring out and catalog the cherished possessions of King Tut, who came to throne when he was only 9 years old. The discovery of Tutankhamun's tomb was a find of a lifetime and rekindled interest in ancient Egypt that lives on today.
I remember when I was 5, I believe. There was some documentary about Tutankhamun's tomb, about entering it. And that's all for today, everyone. We didn't reach Greece today, but we will Thursday. We will Thursday. I'm Brian Croydragon, signing out. Stay shrey!